I have a 16-year-old daughter, and every time she sees me give a talk, she says something to the effect of, "Dad, you're such a geek." So you've been warned. I'm a coastal geologist, and I love geology because it explains the way the world works, why it looks the way it does, and how it got to be that way. And if you listen, it starts to talk to you. An open ocean sandy beach is one of the most dynamic environments on the planet. When I take my students to the coast, I teach them how to read the beach. Is it eroding? Has there been a storm there? Was it a bad one? I teach them to listen to what the beach is telling them. See, storms are the primary drivers of change along our coasts, whether it be erosion, flooding, damage to private property or public infrastructure, storms run the show. And sea level rise allows bigger storm waves and more energy to come closer to shore. And it increases the frequency and extent of destructive and damaging floods. We're seeing it here in Provincetown, on the tip of Cape Cod in Massachusetts. At the Center for Coastal Studies, we've developed a simple, straightforward method that empowers communities and even individuals to prepare for storms and sea level rise. Our method is a mix of available technology, detailed analysis, and meticulous fieldwork that allows us to identify and map the pathways that flowing water will take before an area becomes flooded. We call them storm tide pathways. It's a strategy that is spreading throughout Massachusetts in communities and can be implemented anywhere in the world. On January 4th, in 2018, here in Provincetown, we had a 100-year storm event. That's Commercial Street in Provincetown, the main street in town, about 200 feet away from the beaches on Cape Cod Bay. During this storm, Commercial Street was a river, but this river was flooding with ocean water. These videos were shot before high tide, meaning the waters were still rising. These waters flooded homes and businesses 2 to 3 blocks away, including a church and the basement of Town Hall. It's not hard to imagine what a bigger storm might have done to the main economic engine of town. On that day in January, we were experiencing a spring tide. That's a higher than average high tide that happens every 2 weeks or so. On top of that, we had a storm that brought with it 3 feet of storm surge. On top of that, the storm surge peaked precisely at high tide. You put those three things together, and you've got a massive storm. In this case, a new storm of record, a 100-year storm. The previous high water level was another 100-year storm that happened 40 years earlier. Two different 100-year storm events separated by 40 years, you say? That's a good question to ask, since I just asked it. To be clear, when we say a 100-year storm event, we don't mean we're going to get one of these storms every 100 years on a Tuesday at 3 o'clock in the afternoon. That would be nice, right? We mean that for any given year, there is a 1% chance that we will get a storm that sees waters reach a certain elevation or threshold. So statistically speaking, all other things being equal, we are likely to get one of these storms every 100 years or so. Unfortunately, with climate change, we are moving into a more uncertain future. But however frequent these storms become, they are always major and often catastrophic events. Now, things like storms, wildfires, melting glaciers, these are easy phenomena to engage the public with. We have video footage, harrowing stories, immediate human impacts. But the threats of sea level rise, not so much. Let's try this. Sea level rose about 3 millimeters in Provincetown last year. Say, nothing. 3 millimeters is the thickness of 2 pennies. Not the diameter, but the thickness. Now let's try this. Major hurricanes can see storm surges of 10 to 15 feet. Hurricane Katrina had a 28-foot storm surge. And that's the thickness of about 5,000 pennies, or about the height of the ceiling in this auditorium. It's easy to engage the public when it comes to storms, and hurricanes are the easiest. We name them, we track them, we predict where and when they're going to make landfall. We basically stalk them from the cradle to the grave. We categorize them by wind speed, duration, and energy, and we rank them in terms of death toll and economic loss. 2005 was a monster year for hurricanes. 7 major storms, 4 Category 5s, including Katrina. The Category 5 hurricanes are the highest category, and they have sustained winds of 155 miles per hour. Not gusts, sustained winds. 2017 was another busy hurricane season, including 2 Category 5s, Maria and Irma, with sustained winds of 175 and 180 miles per hour. Some folks thought we should add a Category 6 to the hurricane classification system because these storms are so powerful. Sea level rise, on the other hand, in 2017 was about a tenth of an inch. So another problem that we have with getting the public engaged about the threats of sea level rise is that we're never going to have a monster year for sea level rise. Oof. Remember 2019? Sea level rose a quarter of an inch. Oh yeah, I remember that. That was crazy. So we have a problem, because if sea level did rise by a quarter of an inch every year in Provincetown, it would be double the rate we saw over the last century. The most disconcerting part of this problem is that the projections for sea level rise are much higher than a quarter of an inch per year for the remainder of the 21st century. The best case scenario is 2 feet of sea level rise by 2100. The worst case projections right now are in the neighborhood of 8 feet of sea level rise in 80 years, which frankly is almost unimaginable. And communities like Provincetown and many, many others in the United States and around the world won't be around much longer with those rates of sea level rise without wholesale relocation or substantial mitigation strategies. Now, the reason why I'm talking so much about storms today in a sea level rise presentation is that the effects of sea level rise will most clearly be seen during a storm event. And I want to say that again. The effects of sea level rise will most clearly be seen during a storm event, like the storm we saw here in Provincetown in 2018. So we need a way to deal with an approaching storm at a moment's notice, but also plan for the long term. And mapping of storm tide pathways can help communities mitigate and navigate those rising waters. As with any scientific endeavor, reducing uncertainty is paramount. Our goal was to create maps with as little as uncertainty as possible. The method had to address current and future concerns, require little to no computing resources or expertise, and it had to be accessible. If you can read a map or be taught to read a map, you can use this method. Now, there are lots of sea level rise viewers, I'm sure you've all seen, websites, online data portals that show the extent of flooding associated with storms and sea level rise, but they don't come in formats that can be easily used on a street-by-street basis by the boots-on-the-ground types, the first responders and public works professionals that are charged with going out before and even during a storm, when the rest of us are holed up in our homes. So here's how we did it. Here we are over Provincetown. We take the best available elevation data, in this case something called LIDAR, which is an acronym for light detection and ranging. So think radar, but with light. This yields highly accurate, three-dimensional maps of the Earth's surface. Now we use these LIDAR data to map all the pathways that water could take to give a flood to flood a given area. Here is a screen capture of a website that shows you the extent of flooding in downtown Provincetown for a given water elevation. Where other groups map the extent of flooding state by state, we show you how the water is going to get there street by street. We drape the aerial photograph over the LIDAR data, and now the photograph is in effect a three-dimensional surface. Using the software, we can bring up the water in small increments until the low-lying areas away from the beach have connected with the rising waters. We use our software to draw the profiles over the three-dimensional surface, and the moment the water gets right here, that area begins to flood. And as the water gets to this point, the entire area becomes flooded. These are storm tide pathways. Stop the water here, and you can prevent the flooding. Sometimes it's that simple. Now, the LIDAR data are good, but we need to go out into the field and verify. We use field verification and a survey-grade GPS, or something we call ground truthing, so we can identify and locate each one of these storm tide pathways. You may or may not have noticed the flower pots. I want to go back to the video in 2018. Now, keep your eyes out for that flower pot. Remember, the tides are still rising when these videos were shot. Downtown Provincetown, there's the flower pot on the crown of the road, basically where we identified a storm tide pathway 2 years earlier. That's Provincetown Harbor. There was a lot of damage in the town that day. You can see the water above the bottom of the door here. This one storm event cost the town of Provincetown over $1 million, which obviously doesn't include the cost of private homeowners, owners of businesses, and others. So, We use the best available elevation data, LiDAR and GPS to make our maps, and that's it. Pretty much the lowest amount of uncertainty you could have. And reducing uncertainty is really important when you're dealing with issues that could be life or death. Earlier, I mentioned that the rate of sea level rise around the Northeast was about a foot over the last century. The previous storm of record for this area was the Blizzard of 78, and the waters in Provincetown reached 15.1 feet. In 2018, 40 years later, they reached 15.6. The difference between the old storm of record and the new storm of record was about half a foot, or just about the amount that sea level rose between the time of those two storms. And in case you hadn't heard, the effects of sea level rise will most clearly be seen during a storm event. Now, if you are of the mind that says hope for the best and prepare for the worst, we have a lot to prepare for. But the mapping of storm time pathways can help. Truth be told, many areas in the U.S. and around the world still need lots of help preparing for the best case scenario. It's safe to say few, if any, places are prepared for the worst case scenario of 8 feet of sea level rise in the next 80 years. Now, for me, the most exciting part is that with this method, the right software, a good GPS, and a low-cost drone you could buy on the internet, you could map storm tide pathways just about anywhere in the world. The challenges ahead for dealing with sea level rise and increasing storm intensity need to be addressed now. The climate projections are clear, comprehensive, and self-evident. And if these projections don't move you to action, you're not paying attention. And if you were to ask me why I'm up here today talking to you, I'll finish the way I started. I have a 16-year-old daughter. Thank you.